I'll begin by asking you, what is Green Revolution according to you?
Well, the Green Revolution was a term coined in 1968 to mark the beginning of agricultural progress based on improved yields, productivity improvement. Before that, we were having increased production, but that came from an area expansion, more area under agriculture. From about 1968 onwards, our progress was more towards yield per hectare or per area, and that was caused about by the high yielding varieties of wheat, of rice, of jowar, bajra, maize, and they were all grown with water, irrigation water, and good soil fertility management. The high yielding varieties were capable of converting irrigation water and soil nutrients into grains. This is what we started calling Green Revolution. Originally, it was named as Wheat Revolution because the progress first started in wheat, then it got extended to other crops.
Now, when you were thinking about this concept, since you're considered one of the pioneers, what kind of problems were you facing, say, from the authorities, from the government?
Well, when you know, when the backdrop to our independence was the Great Bengal Famine, 1942-43, where several million people died. This is why our first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru said, everything else can wait but not agriculture, because it was clear. And Mahatma Gandhi said, God is bread to those who are hungry, and it is the fundamental duty of independent India to see that this God prevails in every home and hut of our country. And so people like me who were brought up in the post-independence era, our major aim was how to see that famines like Bengal famine do not recur again. So how do we do it? Only by producing more production within our own country. And also our farm size was small, and the more yield you have, the greater is the marketable surplus. In other words, a small farmer's income can go up only if he or she has more marketable surplus. And that again can come only from yield improvement. This is why from the early 50s, we started working on scientific technologies by which the plants can respond more to nutrients, give more water, because inputs are needed for output. Well, I wouldn't say there were many major problems in the Green Revolution. Fortunately, there are three ingredients which are necessary for the success of any production program. One is technology, economically viable technology, socially acceptable technology, and that was available both from our own work and also from collaboration with people like Dr. Norman Borlaug in Mexico. Secondly, you require public policies, the political will. That also became available in the mid-60s thanks to people like Mr. C. Subramaniam, who was fortunately then the Minister for Food and Agriculture. He took the right policies in terms of pricing. He developed an agricultural prices commission, a method of marketing, and also National Seeds Corporation to produce seeds and so on. So the package of services, the package of public policies, and the package of technology, they all became mutually reinforcing. And when that happens, the progress is fast. And that's what really happened, leading to Green Revolution within a few years.
Now, somewhere along, it is said that the Green Revolution stopped the import of PL480 also. Now, how much do you agree with that?
Well, in 1966, we imported 10 million tons of food grains. That is the highest import we had. It was building up to that level from the late 50s, gradually up to 1966, because 1964-65, there was a severe drought, largely from the PL480 program of the United States of America. By 1971-72, we built up our own grain reserve of nearly 10 million tons from homegrown food, some imported food. And in fact, from that time onwards, we have made some imports, both concessional imports as well as commercial imports. But those have been very marginal in relation to our requirements because of the policy of the Government of India to build up a large grain reserve, buffer stocks as they are called. At one stage, for example, 2 or 3 years ago, we had nearly 30 million tons of food grains in our reserve.
Now, how happy are you with the revolution, say, in the 90s? How is it going in the 90s?
Well, right now, there is some kind of what we call the fatigue of the Green Revolution. There's a little slowing of the pace. Progress is taking place, but on the other hand, our population is increasing, land is shrinking, more and more good arable land is going out of agriculture for construction, for roads, for industry, and so on. And groundwater is going down, unsustainable exploitation. So now we have to see agriculture in terms of more ecological techniques, what we call sustainable agriculture, and it is very important that in both in terms of technology and public policy, we now have a new set of public policies, a new set of technologies.
And where do land reforms figure in this whole equation?
Land reform was one of the planks of independent India. It started with land reform, ceiling to land, distribution of the ceiling surplus land to those who have no land, security of tenure. We had a whole package of land reform. It has gone good and bad and different. States like Kerala and West Bengal have done extremely well in land reform. Many other states are in various stages, I would say, between Kerala and West Bengal and other states. There have been various series of Tamil Nadu has done well and so on. And land reform is fundamental because unless the tiller of the soil has long-term stake in the land, they will not invest on the land. The infrastructure, if I don't own this piece of land, why should I make an investment here? I will not make. That is why land reform, owner cultivation, not absentee landlords, like what was prevalent in British days. Fortunately, absentee landlordism has practically, I wouldn't say completely, practically vanished. This has been a very major achievement of independent India.
But lack of permanent tenancy, whatever you're talking about, does it cause, is it one of the factors contributing to this shift from of people from rural to urban areas?
I would not say that lack of security of tenure is responsible for the rural-urban migration. The rural-urban migration is largely confined to those who have no land at all, like landless labor families, agricultural labor. The loss of rural livelihoods leads them to come in search of jobs to urban areas. I would say it is a symptom of our neglect in terms of investment in rural areas. Even today, people who are well-to-do, if they make some money in village, they invest it in the town. Mahatma Gandhi identified this disease long ago when he said, unless the drain of brain and funds, resources, from the village to the city is stopped, he didn't call it a brain drain going abroad, he called it the brain drain from the village to the town. All educated people emigrating from the village. And now what has happened, the rich people and the well-to-do and the educated have left the village for jobs either in India or abroad. And the poor are coming to the cities and urban slums, what we call environmental refugees. Environmental refugees is now becoming a very serious problem, the loss of livelihoods in rural areas. This can be done only by a massive investment in rural infrastructure, rural roads, rural markets, rural communication, and much more effort in non-farm employment, off-farm employment, not only farm employment, because there's not enough land. We have to create jobs outside the farm sector, in the processing, agro-processing, agri-business, small-scale agri-business, and so on.
Does the state of the village economy today in India concern you?
Very much so. I am very worried about the state of rural economy. The rural India is crying for attention. Attention from scientists, attention from policymakers, attention from bankers and investors. The present system of banking, the transaction costs are so high, they are not able to reach the poor, what we call the unreached. This is why today there's a great deal of emphasis on what is called microcredit, small scale credit operated by the people themselves with a revolving fund. So micro level planning, micro enterprises and microcredit are the way to go. And fortunately, with our Panchayati Raj, elected Panchayati Raj institutions, with one-third woman, I think it should be possible now to reverse our development in favor of small-scale enterprises supported by very low transaction cost credit, not this huge staff and pay commissions and so on.
Now, is the planning process, the five-year plans, have they reflected on agricultural yields and gains? Do you think they have done
every
well?
Every five-year plan, there's a target for agriculture. And by and large, we are reaching the target, somewhat below 5 million tons, 10 million tons. These have been modest targets. They are not very large targets. What is important now is to look upon agriculture, not merely in terms of food production, but in terms of how many jobs it creates, how much more income it gives to the rural people. So that I would say more jobs, more income, and more food should all be there. In the past, our whole agricultural strategy was in terms of tonnage, so many million tons of rice, so many million tons of wheat, and so on. Today, we must go into, we must say, per liter of water, how much we produce of grains or of fruits and vegetables. How many jobs have we created? How much more income we have increased in the villages? That should be our yardstick. not just a million tons of grains. Because our food, our hunger problem in India is not to be measured in million tons of food grains. It has to be measured in million person years of jobs, million person years of livelihoods or income, because the purchasing power is not there. The markets are full of fruits and vegetables and grains, but people still, 300 million people in this country are undernourished.